Morgan, whether you're watching on Facebook Live, we welcome you here as well as we come to worship this morning. Just going to get some scripture with you before we pray and before we sing our first couple of songs. And our scripture this morning is taken from John chapter 20, verse 24. If you press the logo again and then turn it off. Thank you. So John chapter 20, verse 24. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands a mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas said to them, "Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.'" Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." This morning now we come and we worship our Lord and our God. That's who we come to this morning. We come to worship Him. We come to acknowledge Him as our Lord and our Saviour. And that's why we're going to sing together this morning. We're going to sing two songs. But before we do, let's pray together. Lord God, we just come to you this morning and we thank you that we can come together in your place to worship you. We thank you, Lord, that we are able to sing praises to you. We thank you, Lord, that you are alive. Lord, that we can know you with us, Lord God. And we just pray, Lord, that you will bless us as we worship you this day. In your name, Lord. Amen. We're going to stand and we're going to sing two songs together, "How Can It Be?" and "An Amazing Grace."
Thank you.
present.
In the very moment. I'm not going to invite us to this, where you can see you in the face. Or in fact, if you lay yourself there in some way, we ask that you open our eyes, that we might be able to hold all this life we have to ourselves, to our family, to our souls.
join in with us as we sang together. The children are going to head out now to Sunday school. As we turn to the sermon yesterday, so the children are just going to head out. And the Sunday school teachers and the kids as they've gone out with us now. Again, Lord, we just pray, Lord, you will equip those who are teaching teach well. Lord, we pray for the children as they hear your word taught just now. Lord, may they too understand as we do, as you are teaching us as well. Lord, I ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Now we're turning to Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 to 31 to give me. There's three passages and I'll read them out. In Genesis 1, 2 and 3, so a few short passages just to give us a snapshot really of what's been going on in the scripture here. As we continue in our series of what we believe, we're going to be looking at humanity and sin today. And we're going to look at what we believe in regards to humanity and sin. So Genesis chapter 1 verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds and of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." And God said, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Moving over to Genesis chapter 2 now, and verse 15 through 17. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. And then moving on to Genesis chapter 3, starting at verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Did God actually say, 'You shall not eat of any tree in the garden?'" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall we touch it, lest you die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit of the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock, and above all the beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." To the woman he said, "I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be contrary to your husband, but he shall rule over you." And to Adam he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife, and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. But the sweat of your face you shall eat. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, for you are dust." Have you ever looked at anything and thought, "I really must have that. I really must have that. I will do anything to obtain it"? Because I'm sure you've all experienced this. A young boy one day reached his hand into the cookie jar that had been placed out of his reach. He reaches his hand in and he grabs the cookie. He can't get his hand out. He's pulling, and his hand is stuck. And so he calls out to his mum, who tries everything she can think of to help pull her son's hand out of the cookie jar. Soap, cooking oil, everything, even yanking it, everything to try and get the hand out. But the hand is stuck completely. Finally, the mum says, "We're just going to have to break the cookie jar to get your hand out." may hurt, and we're going to have to do it. And the boy looked up to his mum with big eyes, afraid of the pain that's going to come. Simply asked, would it help if I let go of the crutch? You see, when we let go of the things that we want, it's always a lot easier to free ourselves, isn't it? It's always a lot easier to free ourselves of the pain of not getting our hand out of the cookie. Yeah. I won't tell you whether that was me or not. As a young boy, certainly known to take a cookie or two. Over these last couple of weeks, we've been looking at what it is that we believe and why we believe it. We looked at a couple of weeks ago, didn't we, at the supremacy of Scripture, why taking the Word of God as written, as the sole authority for our life, the sole authority on which we base our lives on, the sole authority on which we understand the voice of God. And then last week we looked at the doctrine of God. Who is God? Why should we believe in Him? And we looked at the fact that God is Father, Spirit, and Son, and we call that the Trinity. We looked at the fact that they are co-equal in power and glory. We looked at all three persons of the Godhead, of God as we would call Him in singular terms, because He is one, that they are equally 100% involved in creation, in salvation, and in sanctification. And today we're going to be moving on a little bit from this. So we've laid the foundation really of where we're going in this series of looking at what we believe and why we believe it. We now know that everything we know of God is based on Scripture. What He has revealed to us in His written word, primarily. And what His written word has revealed to us is the fact that He is one God, Father, Spirit, and Son, but one. We looked at the fact that God is the creator of all things. Do you like to bring up the PowerPoint there? The creator of all things. And because He's the creator of all things, we also recognize that He's the creator of us, human beings. And so we're going to look at humanity today. And one of the things that we will notice as we were reading Scripture and as we go through this one is about that we are created in the image of God, and therefore every human being has absolute worth. Doesn't matter where we were born, doesn't matter how rich or poor we are, what our ethnicity is, we are all created in the image of God, and therefore we have the worth of the image of God in us and on us. And that's our starting point when we look at humanity. But we also have to recognize that we ourselves have tainted that image because of the fall. Our worth is based on the fact that we are created in the image of God. But we as human beings, as fallen creatures, sin. And so we're going to look at the fall today, and we're going to look at the effects of sin as we progress. So let's look at the image of God. If we turn to chapter 1, verse 26, we will see that God says, let us make man in our image. And there we have the Trinity right there. It's a God singular, but describing himself in the plural. And he says, let us make man in our image. That's not to say that God looks and has a body like us, because he doesn't. The only time God has a body like us is when he was walking this earth as the Son, Jesus. However, we are created in his image. In other words, what Scripture is telling us is our worth is based on the fact that God has created us in his image. He has put his seal on us, and he's made us different to the rest of creation. This goes countercultural to our day, but animals are not the same as human beings. They do not have the same worth. They do not have the same dignity as human beings. That's not to say they don't have worth or they don't have dignity in what they are created to be. But they're not the same as human beings. They are not created in the image of God. I do not believe they will live forever, unlike humanity. Whether that's with God or separated from God in eternal punishment, we will come on to that later. We are different. And the reason why we know we're different is because when we look at the creation accounts in Genesis 1 and 2, the only time God talks about creating something in his image is about humanity. Everything else, he speaks and it is done. But humanity takes his time. He forms us. Man out of the dust, and Scripture tells us woman out of man. And all of us, man and women, are created in the image of God. We are created with the dignity that comes with that. We are created to reflect the glory of God in creation. And part of that glory and dignity that God has given humanity is that we are to rule over God's world. No other part of creation is given that mandate. But humanity. We also see that when God creates at the end of each day, God said it was good. When he created humanity, he says it was very good. Now again, I know the English translation from the original, we often lose a lot. And there's a difference there, so that in the English we add the word very into that, to help us see that God is setting humanity apart from the rest of creation. It's almost as if God has made the cosmic cake, if you like, and he's brought it together and he places the cherry on the top. Mankind. He says, there. I've done everything I want to do now. Because the very next day, what does God do? He rests. He's happy with what he's made. He can rest because he's created humanity to rule the world that he has created. Now, scripture doesn't tell us how long this state of paradise lasts for. It doesn't tell us how long the first people, Adam and Eve, walked with God, ruling his creation well. Scripture does not tell us that. What it does tell us is the next major point. We call that the fall. We call that the fall. And even in the fall, we have to remember that each one of us has been created for the glory of God. And so when we come to the way in which we interact with each other, the way we treat each other, we have to treat each other with the dignity that God has given each one of us. We are to be people of peace, not people of division. We are to make sure that our needs are met, whatever they are. Because each one of us has a divine given dignity. But we come to the fall. Yes, scripture tells us this is a real life event. It really happened. And it's not a figure of speech. It is not poetry. This is history. It's important we understand that, because without it being history, how can we actually explain our sin nature? When God created the world and created humanity, it was very good. So good that he rested. And he let man do the job that he gave man to do. And yet, when we look at the world today, we cannot say it is very good. We cannot say that it has gone to plan. Unless the fall is a real historical event, we cannot explain our sin nature adequately. I know that goes against a lot of what we're taught in this day and age. It's important we understand, it's important we take scripture at its word when it's meant to, and it's given to us in a way that's meant to be taken at its word. Certain points of scripture are poetry. We can see the beauty of the poetry in that, and there's lessons to be learned, and God is conveying something of himself in that poetry. This is not one of those places. This is given to us as history, so we have to read it as history. So let's look at the history of it, shall we? Well, the first point, we see there's a command. In chapter 2, verses 16 to 17, the command is, you can eat of any tree in the garden but one. You can eat of any tree in the garden where you've been placed to work for God in his creation. You can eat of any tree but one. And the one tree is right there in the midst of the garden, and it's a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Why does God place that restriction on humanity? Well, first of all, when we look at it, and we look at the world and the size of the world that God has created, and the amount of vegetation, etc., that God has created in the world, and the amount different kinds of plants and trees that God has said you can eat, is it really that much of a restriction?
It's like a little boy who can help himself to anything in the kitchen with the cookie jar.
Where do we want to go to? We want to go to that cookie jar. We want to go to that tree, don't we?
I don't think it's that unfair of God to say you can have all of this but this one thing.
After all, God created it. He sets the parameters. He sets the rules of what is allowed and what is not allowed in this world. He created it. If I create a computer program, I wouldn't know the first thing. I wouldn't know where to start if I was going to try. I'll say that to begin with. But if I were to create a computer program, I set the parameters of which that computer program is going to work within. And it can't work outside of what I've set. So I don't think it's unfair of God to set the rules, the boundaries in which we can live and work for Him. So the command was, you can eat of anything but this one tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And He says, the consequence is, you will die. So we have the command, we have the consequence in verse 17. You will die if you eat it. Very clear. Very clear boundaries and very clear consequences given. In other words, what God is saying is, if you think you can do better without me, that's what sin is. It's wanting to do things our own way, not God's way. Then the consequence of that is death. Our physical death doesn't happen immediately. But when we are living as our own gods, we are dead. We are dead spiritually. We are dead emotionally. We are dead in every way, but physically, until our physical death begins. Unless we are being brought back to life through the life and death of Jesus, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But I don't want to spoil next week too much, we'll be looking at salvation next week. So we won't be dwelling too much on that today. So as I say, God has set the boundaries in which we are to operate. It's a bit like a team sport. Say football, for instance. If we all just run onto the pitch and play by our own individual rules, it's mayhem. But when you compete within the rules of a game, it's far more enjoyable both to participate in but also to watch. The problem is, in this world, we all want to live by our own rules. It's okay for me, so therefore it's okay. You cannot tell me how to live my life. We hear that all the time, don't we? You see, when God was setting the boundaries on the first people, Adam and Eve, He's actually telling them how to enjoy the freedom they have been given. How to enjoy the creation God has given them. how to enjoy relationships with each other, how to enjoy a relationship with Him. It is healthy, it is clear. And when God puts the one restriction on them, He's saying, do you trust me enough to provide for you? Do you trust me that I love you enough that I will not let things go against you? That you will always have what you're going to need? Do you trust me enough? And to eat of the forbidden tree would be to seek right and wrong independently from God. Do we trust God enough to provide? Will we live by divine revelation, or will we live by human reason? And that is the choice that stands before each one of us every single day. Will we live by divine revelation as revealed to us through Scripture and through the person and life and work of Jesus Christ? Or will we live by human reason? Will we live by what feels right to me in the moment? Will we seek what is right and wrong independently of God? And so we come to the temptation. And as we come to the temptation, we notice that it is a role reversal here. Notice Adam is the one who has been given the command by God, not Eve. That is because Adam had been charged with ruling his family, not in an overbearing, manipulative way, which a lot of people seem to do, but in a loving, nurturing way, making sure that his family knew the command of God and knew how to obey it, to teach his family. And that is a man's responsibility even now, to make sure that we are teaching our family the truth about God. That's not to say that we do everything. That's not to say there's only one way to do that. Each family has to work out their own way of how that's going to look for their family. But it's a man's responsibility, ultimately. He is the one who will be held responsible for his family's relationship with God. And do you notice that Satan, even though Adam and Eve are together, he targets Eve? In other words, he's testing, has Adam done his job? Has he done it well? Has he done it well? And when we see the events unfold, we have to say, Adam failed. Which is why we're seeing these Adams and not Eve's, even though she's the one who leads first. It is Adam that is held responsible for that action. He's the one who fell short first. Satan, going after Eve, is also trying to create division between husband and wife, or between humanity and God. And we see that so often in the power struggles that we see in families up and down this country. between the state and its citizens. Power struggle after power struggle after power struggle, because we all want to be in charge. We all want to be our own little gods. That is a direct consequence of the fall. So we come to what Satan does as he takes on the form of a serpent. He lies three times to get Eve to believe the lie. The first one, did God really say, or in the translation we read earlier, did God actually say, you cannot eat of any tree in the garden? Did God actually say that? Surely God wouldn't say that. He's questioning the trustworthiness of God. He's misrepresenting God's command. Remember, God said, you can eat of any tree but one. Satan says, did God really say you can't eat of any tree? Also notice the way he represents God. Up until now, it's the Lord God that we're reading. No, it's Yahweh, the name of God, the personal God who has created us and wants a relationship with us. And later on, when God is walking, that's how God reveals himself. But here, Satan says, God, the generic name of God, or title of God, should I say. In other words, he's saying, I don't mind that you believe in God. I mean, he clearly created you here. He clearly met him. I don't mind that you know he's there. But I don't want you to know him. I don't want you to have a relationship with him. He doesn't mind religion. He doesn't mind how religious we are today. What he minds is when we know God, when we know the Lord. My Lord and my God, Thomas says as he bows down to Jesus, we read at the beginning. Did God really say? And every time we question, did God really say that? Is that really what God wants of humanity? Is that really the way of salvation? Is that really how we're to worship God? Is that really what God has said? Every time we say that, we're believing the same lie that Eve and Adam believed in the garden. The second line, verse 4, you won't die. God has said, if you eat of this one tree, if you eat the fruit of it, you will die. God knew that physically we wouldn't die immediately. God's not a vengeful God. God is a patient, loving God who gives us time and time and time again to repent. And the way in which he does it in the garden is teaches us something of his heart and his love and his desire to see us return to him. But he knew that we will die. Then and then, our relationship with God will die. Our relationship with each other dies there and then. Our relationship with creation dies there and then. We become aloof to each other. We try and exert our authority over each other. And it's all a sign of the death that we have died because of sin. What Satan is offering here is sin without conscience. He's trying to make out that because Satan knows that we must physically die there and then, so he's trying to make God out to be a liar. He's trying to say that you can sin without suffering the consequences of it. And sometimes when we don't see the immediate consequences of something that we've done wrong, we think we've got away with it, don't we? And then when we're questioned about it, we lie about it. We try to lie our way out of it. It's a human condition. You ever notice children do that automatically? This is how we know that all of humanity is fallen. All of humanity is fallen, even at birth. We're not born innocent. Again, that goes against what our culture says and what our culture believes. That's what the Word of God teaches. All of sin falls short of the glory of God. There is not one of us righteous. Not one of us capable of bridging the gap between ourselves and God. And the third lie, in verse 5, you will be like God. You will be like God. You can replace God in your own life. You can make up your own rules and live by them. It's okay. You can decide what is right and wrong. Your morality is your morality. No one else can tell you what is right and wrong. What we have to do is turn on our TVs. Any program we watch, we hear that mantra. We hear that doctrine that you are your own God. You make up your own right and wrong. It doesn't matter what type of program it is. It doesn't matter whether it's a children's cartoon or an adult thriller. Blockbuster movie, it does not matter, it's there in everything. And once we've seen it, we can't unsee it. Well, that's the lie Satan gives Eve, and that's the lie Satan gives to each one of us today. Does God really say, you won't die, you can live without the consequences, you can be like God, you can be your own God? You can make up the rules as you go along. What about the effects of sin? Well, we don't need to go very far in Scripture to see how each generation adds and adds and adds to that original sin. We see murder, we see fighting, we see sexual immorality, we see it all there, the first few chapters of Genesis, it's all there. And I haven't got out of chapter 3, and I'm not going to today. We're not going to look at what comes next. We're going to look at Adam and Eve and the way it affects them. Because it's the same in each generation. The first thing it affects is they stop trusting in the goodness of God. What do they notice? They notice their nakedness. They notice their shame and their guilt, and they hide from God, the one who created them. They can't stand to be in His presence any longer. Why? Because of sin. They know it immediately. That relationship is dead. Then they no longer trust that when God finds out, that God isn't just going to zap him dead right there and there. They can no longer trust him not to do that. That's not because God has given them any reason not to trust them, but because of their sin, they don't know what to believe anymore. They don't know what is right and wrong, and they can't figure it out themselves. So they hide. There's a lack of trust in each other and in the creation order. They begin to blame each other when God calls out. What's the first thing Eve says? Oh, sorry, Adam says. It was Eve's fault. Eve says it's the serpent's fault. They don't take responsibility for their own actions. There's an inability to take responsibility. They blame each other. Their relationship with each other has broken. They can no longer trust each other to do the right thing. We see here in the garden that God, despite our sin, seeks us out and seeks for us to take responsibility for our sin, to take account. He calls us to account for our sin. When God calls out to Adam, it's not because he doesn't know where Adam is. It's not because he doesn't know what Adam has done. Where are you? Who told you you were naked? What have you done? He's not asking those questions because he doesn't know. God is all-knowing. God is all-powerful. He asks because he wants Adam to say, I didn't do my job well enough. I take responsibility for that. And I ate the fruit. I chose the fruit. It was me. It's my fault. He wants to give Adam a chance to own up. He wants to give Adam a chance to stop hiding and to come to him. To be clothed in God's righteousness. To restore what was broken. But Adam can't do that. And so we see the effects of sin. The death of our relationship with God. The death of our relationship with each other. There is a physical death. Yes, it doesn't come immediately. But that was never part of paradise. We suffer a spiritual death, we suffer a relational death. And even the environment, even the creation itself is dying because of sin. It's not because of what the world teaches, it's because of. It's because of sin the world is dying. It's because of sin we are dying. It's because of sin there's pain and suffering in this world. And when I say it's because of sin, I'm talking about original sin. Although our own individual actions can cause pain, can cause suffering to each other from time to time. So it doesn't negate our personal responsibilities for the pain and suffering around us. Yes, we have not used the world's resources wisely that God has given us, and that is on us. We have to use what we've been given well. We have a responsibility to rule this world well. But it's not dying because we've misused it well. It was already misused the world's resources. It's dying because of sin. It was already dying, and it will die. God's word tells us he will bring this world to an end because of sin. It will bring this life to an end because of sin. And the only way to live, the only way for this world to be restored is in Jesus Christ, where he will make a new heaven and a new earth, where he will give us new bodies that is free from pain and suffering. If we trust in Jesus as our Lord and our Savior, we trust him for the forgiveness of our sins. We rest in him and we allow him to restore the relationships that have been broken, ultimately between ourselves and God, but with each other, between one ethnic group and another ethnic group, where we are one together, united, one family in Christ Jesus. Between husband and wife, father and children, mother and children, where relationships are restored because of Jesus Christ. We cannot do it on our own. The gap is too big for us to bridge. And the gap is too big because of sin. And sin entered the world because of the fall. We were created, in conclusion this morning, we were created in the image of God, and we were designed to bring God glory. That's why God created us, and that's what God is going to restore those who are in Christ Jesus back to in the new heaven and the new earth, which will include, I'm sure, trees and animals and all the rest of it, but new creations. The only ones who will go from here to there is humanity, those who are in Christ Jesus. It's not universal. It's offered to everybody, but only those in Christ Jesus will receive and will escape the consequences of sin. And that the sin, the original sin, was not the eating of the fruit, it was wanting to replace God. Notice the first line doesn't work entirely within. She says, well, actually, God did say we can't eat. We can eat of anything but this one fruit. You know, she says that. In fact, she adds more to it. She actually adds to the word of God by saying we can't even touch it. Religion starting already, where we start to put our own rules around it to make sure we don't even come close to breaking the rules. That's what religion does. Even the lie that we won't die doesn't fully work. It's when Satan says she will be like God. And she looks at the tree and she realizes it's beautiful to look at. It's going to taste lovely because everything else we've eaten so far tastes lovely. So why wouldn't this? It looks the best quality out there. But it'll also give me wisdom like God. That's a in which Satan gets in. That's a hook in which Adam bites. That's a hook in which we bite time and time and time again. Sin is wanting to replace God, not give God the glory, not give God the honor that he is due because he created us. We are created beings. We are not the creator. We are not God. And the consequence of sin is death. And we suffer a slow, painful death outside of Christ Jesus. We need salvation, and the only salvation that is worth anything, the only salvation that works and will save us from the consequence of sin and death is Jesus. His death, His resurrection. And we will look at that next week when we look at salvation. We were created in the image of God. We have tainted that image by desiring to replace God with ourselves. My prayer for you, my prayer for each one of us is that we will know the salvation, we will know the peace that comes with knowing Christ as Lord and Savior, trusting Him, that He has done enough to bridge the gap between ourselves and the Father. Shall we pray? Lord God, Lord, we come to you this morning and we acknowledge, Lord, that you are God, you are the one that created all that we see. We acknowledge, Lord, that you created each one of us, male and female, black, white, young, old, each one of us in your image, and you have given us a dignity that comes with the image of you in us. Lord, we also come acknowledging, Lord, that we are a race tainted by sin. Lord, that we have fallen short of your glory. We have fallen short of the image, Lord, that you placed in us. And Lord, that we have tried replacing you with ourselves. We have tried making up our own rules, living by our own morality, deciding what is right and wrong for ourselves. Lord, I thank you for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Lord, we have received the forgiveness and we are no longer that sinner. We are now saints in Christ. And we praise you for that, Lord. Equip us, continually fill us with your Spirit, Lord, so that we can continually resist temptation. Say no to it. Turn our back to it and turn to you each and every time. And Lord, forgive us those times when we give in to temptation. But Lord, for those of us who as yet are not in Christ Jesus, whether here personally or watching online right now, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you will come to them, Lord, that you will convict them of their own sin, Lord, their own responsibility of that. And Lord, that you will show them how much you love them, how much you have forgiven them in Christ Jesus. And Lord, that they will surrender to you just now as Lord, as Savior, as God and King. And Lord, that they will trust, Lord, that your forgiveness is enough, as we ourselves have done. Father, I pray this in your name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing the song that we finished with last week, Yet Not I, But Christ in Me. And as we do, we will wait upon you and for your offering. here to follow the hallway system, and we go out down the middle and out through the back door there, and to have our conversations outside their clothes. Our Bible study on Tuesday at 8 o'clock will continue on Zoom, and we're looking at John chapter 10, verse 22 to the end of the chapter, and the login details are on the screen there as well. Next Sunday, our worship service will be at 10:30 here at St. George's National School. We will have a communion next week as well. So we would ask if you to bring your own bread, that the juice are individual cups, so we can provide them. But to bring your own bread, it just helps minimise any risks at the moment. I know most of us are starting to get vaccinated and things like that. But to continue in this, just until some more restrictions are lifted, really, at the moment, in that way. And so please come to prepare for that. And then we will also have a prayer meeting next Sunday evening on Zoom. I don't have a slide, I forgot to put that up. But we'll have a prayer meeting next Sunday at 8 o'clock on Zoom as well. They've been the same over the years, as well, by the Sunday. And then on the 20th of June, last week we were due to have our AGM. We weren't able to host it, and we have to give 2 weeks notice for the date. So next Sunday is 2 weeks, and so the earliest we can now hold it really is the 20th of June. So please come prepared for that. Everyone's allowed to stay and be part of that. Just to remind you of that. Our benediction is from John chapter 20, and the end of the chapter, verse 39. These things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name. That's my prayer for each one of us, that we will have life in His name.